history is most forward cycles.
Good morning, everyone. If I could ask you to find your seats, we're going to get things started in just a moment. So, good morning, everybody. I'm Daryl Kimball. I'm Executive Director of the Arms Control Association. And as most of you know, we were formed in 1971 to deal with the world's most dangerous weapons, to try to eliminate the threats that they pose to all of us. And I want to welcome all of you to our meeting today, our 2015 annual meeting, including those of you online looking at us online through our webcast. So for those of you here, be careful about the strange faces you might make when I say certain things, because you're on camera too. This meeting and the work of the Arms Control Association is the result of a great team of people, our staff, our board, and our supporters, our loyal members of this organization. And before we start on the great program that we have here today that's outlined in the program guide, I want to just quickly thank a few of our key staff people and loyal funders for their contributions and work that make all of this possible, including the Plowshares Fund, the MacArthur Foundation, the Carnegie Corporation New York, the William and Flora Hewlett Foundation, the Prospect Hill Foundation, and others. And we're also very grateful to a few individuals who have made special contributions and table sponsorships to help defray the cost of this event. And they are David and Gina Halfmeister, Michael Clare, one of our board members, our Vice Chairman Paul Walker, sitting here at the Walker table. Yes. And our friend and one of the parents of the Nuclear Nonproliferation Treaty, Larry Weiler, and also one anonymous donor. And I also just want to say a few words about somebody else we're immensely thankful and grateful to who isn't here today, who helped shape this organization and guide and lead this organization for more than a quarter century. And he's John Steinbrenner. And John, as most of you know, our board chairman, our friend, our colleague, and mentor, he passed away on April the 16th in his home in Northwest Washington following a 9-year struggle with multiple myeloma. And for many of us here who knew John and had the privilege to work with him, learn from him, I'm sure you'll all agree that he was an unusually insightful and creative thinker, a persistent advocate for sensible security policies on a range of things, avoiding great power conflict, regional war, to guard against dangerous pathogens, to slow climate change, prevent cyber attacks, regulate space weaponry, and more than anything else, to prevent nuclear war. He worked for many years down the street at the Brookings Institution shaping their work, and beginning in 1991, he joined the board of the Arms Control Association, became the chairman of the board in 2000, just before I arrived, and he oversaw the rejuvenation of the organization, encouraged us to work on a wider range of issues, and helped us through some tough organizational and policy challenges over many years. So, all of us in the Arms Control Association family and the wider peace and security community are far wiser and stronger because of him and his dedication to a better world. And of course, on top of that, he was just a really wonderful and warm human being. So let me just note that next week at 4 p.m. on May 19th at the University of Maryland's Memorial Chapel, there's going to be a formal public memorial service for John that's open for anyone here who would like to go. I hope many of you can join us on the staff, his faculty colleagues at the University of Maryland, his many students and colleagues there to help celebrate his life. But for today, with John in our minds, we want to continue the work that I think he would have wanted us to continue to pursue, to deal with the problems that have to be dealt with, to deal with the issues that he was so concerned about for many, many years. And we're going to be looking at three main issues today: Russia, the West, and the future of arms control, which we're calling the Big Chill; the future of the NPT as it enters something of a midlife crisis; and the ongoing challenge of preventing a nuclear-armed Iran through the P5+1 and Iran nuclear deal. So as you can see from the program, we've got a really fantastic set of speakers to help us analyze all these issues and to offer some concrete solutions about how to deal with them. And after we have a buffet lunch, we're honored to have as our keynote speaker Ambassador Alex Kmet of Austria, who just arrived from a long journey from New York, which was not easy this week given the train tragedy outside of Philadelphia. He's going to describe in his lunch address the thinking behind the humanitarian impacts of nuclear weapons initiative that's changed the global conversation on nuclear weapons, and also talk about the NPT. And then following our panel on the P5+1 and Iran nuclear negotiations, after lunch, we're really lucky to have with us as our closing keynote speaker Colin Call, the National Security Advisor for Vice President Biden, who's with us here today and not at Camp David with all of the Gulf Cooperation Council leaders to talk about the P5+1 and Iran agreement and the next steps in the long-running effort to deal with Iran's nuclear program. But first, this morning, is our opening panel on the U.S.-Russian relationship, and I want to invite our moderator, Greg Thielmann, Catherine, and Matt, our panelists, to come on up right now so we can get started. And as they come forward and get seated, let me invite those of you with your smartphones that can penetrate the thick walls of this building, or if you're online through the guest access wireless, to tweet about what you're hearing, to tweet your thoughts with the hashtag ArmsControl2015. And if you could, please turn your ringers off on your phone so that we're not disturbed. And then finally, and before Greg takes over, I want to thank our friends at the Hoover Institution for the complimentary copies of the new and important book, edited by Ambassador Jim Goodby, who's here, our longtime friend and collaborator, and former Secretary of State George Shultz, The War That Must Never Be Fought. It's a meaty book with a lot of important ideas written by some of the best minds in the fields and there are some practical ideas and solutions to encourage us to transform our thinking about deterrence and nuclear weapons and deal with what George Shultz writes, and I agree, is the problem of nuclear weapons, which were and are the greatest threat to humanity's survival. So let me turn over the chair to Greg and the panel, and thank you all for being here today.
Thank you, Daryl. It's not very controversial these days to describe our current times as manifesting the low point in Russia's relations with the West since the Cold War. And yet, this big chill in relations is not quite a return to the Cold War, as I think many of you who are Cold War veterans in the room can attest to. After all, Russia does continue to abide by the new Strategic Arms Reduction Treaty, which I think is extremely important for moderating the worst-case estimates of the two sides and maintaining a downward vector in the nuclear arsenals of the two largest nuclear powers by far. It's also true that Russia continues to be a constructive partner in the Iran talks that Daryl just mentioned. And this is arguably, at least for the moment, one of the highest priorities for nonproliferation among the UN Security Council members. As everyone noticed, the U.S. Secretary of State just spent a lot of time talking to Russian leaders in Sochi, first nearly 4 hours with Foreign Minister Lavrov, and then 4 hours with President Putin. And as the New York Times commented you know things are bad when a meeting that doesn't achieve anything is considered good news. I think whether or not it's achieved anything, of course, is a little premature to say. But this kind of dialogue at this time, I think, is definitely good news. I can't resist a mention also of other U.S. and Russians in regular contact. Even as we speak, they're flying overhead on the International Space Station. Two American astronauts, three Russian cosmonauts. From the distance that you have to this picture, they are very hard to distinguish. They just kind of all look like Earthlings. The only one which you may be able to distinguish is there is an Italian woman there that at least is a different gender than the others. But it's an encouraging sight and useful sometimes to remember that at least in this case, the regular U.S. Russian contact seems to be quite harmonious, professional, and successful. We have two experts on our panel today to help us sort out the reasons for Russia's chilly relations with the West and also the implications for arms control. You have many fun facts of a biographic nature in your program, but just to at least identify the current highlights, Matthew Rojansky is director of the Kennan Institute at the Woodrow Wilson International Center for Scholars, and he's a former deputy director of the Carnegie Endowment's Russia and Eurasia program. Catherine Kelleher is a professor at the University of Maryland's Public Policy School, senior fellow at the Watson Institute for International Studies at Brown University, and an esteemed member of the ACA Board of Directors. And I would also mention that Catherine and I were both commissioners and are commissioners on the Trilateral Deep Cuts Commission, and you will have noticed the second annual report on the table outside. This is another occasion for sustained contact between, in this case, Russians, Americans, and Germans to discuss ways to deal with the challenges of making progress on arms control. So we're going to first turn to Matt to give us some political context on this issue. And I wanted to start with the often quoted remarks of President George W. Bush after first meeting President Vladimir Putin in 2001. He said, "I found him to be very straightforward and trustworthy, a man deeply committed to his country and the best interests of his country." So I want to ask Matt, in the course of his setting the political context, to also discuss whether we need to update that assessment of Putin, and also get maybe at some of the personal dynamics that color our success or failure in pursuing arms control. Matt?
Okay. Thank you very much, Greg, and thank you, Daryl. It's an honor to be here. It's always an honor to be on a panel with Catherine. We were both associated with another effort called the Euro-Atlantic Security Initiative, which was largely promulgated by the Carnegie Endowment with some international partners, and it was a very different time. It was a time at which some very distinguished and impressive Russians, Europeans, Americans were able to sit down and come up with an inclusive and comprehensive vision for security from Vancouver to Vladivostok that actually seemed pretty real and pretty achievable at that moment. From today's vantage point, it won't surprise you that I tend to think much of that effort has been completely overlooked, if not for naught. Let me take a bit of a stroll down memory lane for many of you in this room, but just try to elucidate how we got to where we are, but with one particular theme, and that's the theme of cycles. And it's very striking to me that this very week, coming on the heels of months and months in which the message from the White House and the State Department, from the Chancellery in Germany, from Brussels, has been no more business as usual. We are done with cycles. We don't trust the Russians. We are done. It's back to containment. We're going to reestablish NATO as a credible deterrent, and we're going to treat Russia as the adversary that it now clearly is. And then once again, we have Secretary Kerry showing up and seeking to square the circle, perhaps in the Russian term, his counterpart, Minister Lavrov, described it as seeking normalization, recognizing that one needs a normal relationship. So perhaps once again, we're starting on the upswing of yet another of these seemingly endless cycles. How did this pattern begin and why? If you go back to the 1990s, you have what I refer to as the Bill and Boris show. This was a very personality-dependent relationship between Bill Clinton and Boris Yeltsin. They created a number of institutions. Most of them, though, were heavily dependent on the will of the two presidents and, to some extent, their deputies. Al Gore and Victor Chernomyrdin chaired the famous Gore-Chernomyrdin Commission with its many working groups. But at the same time that all of this was happening, there were deep underlying political trends which were, from the Russian perspective, fundamentally incompatible with the relationship that both sides expressed a hope was emerging in the post-Cold War period. The one we hear the most about is NATO expansion, but it's by no means the only one. There was a series, the sort of theme of the 1990s, if you will, was a series of developments in the global political, legal, diplomatic, and economic order, all of which were seen from Moscow as being subservient to an American agenda, with the not surprising result that when you reached the end of the 1990s and came into the 2000s, the election of George W. Bush and the selection of Vladimir Putin in Russia, the result was a Russia and an America which were fundamentally positioned to see the world in very different ways. George W. Bush had the idea that rather than the kind of intense love and personality-dependent relations of the Clinton years, which of course famously came crashing down with the bombing campaign against Kosovo, causing Primakov to literally turn his airplane around, cancel a visit to the United States, and then the return of the Siloviki, the power ministries, and the spies under the leadership of Vladimir Putin, that George W. Bush would seek to have a normal relationship with Russia. That is, a relationship as one would have with any other country. So when you agree on things, you work together. When you disagree on things, you sort of put those aside and you manage your differences. Unfortunately, despite Bush's deep gaze into Putin's eyes, despite a relatively pragmatic, optimistic, I would even say a realist Vladimir Putin 15 years ago, a man who frequently said to his American interlocutors, whom he insisted still on calling partners up until the last year, believe it or not, he always referred to the United States as partners. Despite all of that, what we found ourselves falling into was a situation in which you could not treat Russia merely as just another country. What ended up happening was that Russia received almost no high-level attention when Condoleezza Rice, herself first as National Security Advisor, then as Secretary, herself a Russia expert, was nominally tapped by George W. Bush to sort of head the institutional side of the U.S.-Russia relationship. That focus very quickly devolved first to her deputy, Steve Hadley, and then on down the line, such that senior folks who worked in the White House at that time will tell you that there was essentially no one at the wheel of the Russia account for quite a long time. And the unfortunate truth with Russia is whether the relationship is scary and dysfunctional or it's over-promising and over-optimistic, it can never be normal. It always has to be a special relationship, and I think we've seen that very clearly illustrated over the last quarter century. The results were clear. By 2008, the United States and Russia were nearly at blows over NATO expansion, color revolutions throughout the post-Soviet space, of course, the Russia-Georgia conflict, and many other issues. So then along comes Barack Obama in 2009, through actually Vice President Biden, who first used the term in a speech. He announces the idea of a reset, And the idea of the reset at this time really is taken, I think, by both sides as an effort to clear the air, right? That there had been too much sort of cyclical love, hate, too much intense expectation, disappointment, and then frustration. The idea in particular with the arrival of President Medvedev a year before Obama comes to office is, you know, these are modern guys. They're lawyers, they're constitutional law scholars, they both use iPads and the internet, right, unlike their predecessors. They could have a working business-like relationship. They could agree to disagree, but then agree to cooperate in a way that their predecessors hadn't. So on a certain level, right, this worked out rather well. We achieved a whole host of what a lot of folks have now called the low-hanging fruit in the relationship, including, obviously, the New START agreement. But I would say it was characterized by two problematic phenomena, the underlying trends in this period. One, the relationship was still heavily personality dependent. To the extent that Obama and Medvedev were personally committed to it, to the extent that they had frequent and long personal interactions and largely positive, the relationship worked. To the extent that it fell to others who didn't have that same personal dynamic, the relationship didn't work. And second, that many of, and I would even say most of the achievements, and I won't go through the list, are not only low-hanging fruit, but they were things that were long overdue or things that we had achieved before and thrown out the window. For example, we created a bilateral presidential commission. We had had the Gorchernomyrdin Commission, except that we threw it out the previous time we had a crisis. We got the New START agreement. I seem to recall, maybe others in this room recall, we had had functional arms control agreements. We just had failed to achieve within a timely manner renewals or extensions or updates to those agreements. Similarly with Afghanistan, it's a 150-year-old problem. We got a northern distribution network to kind of manage and keep that problem under control, but nothing resembling a fundamental transformation of the relationship. So when people use the term reset, what they're really talking about was just clearing enough of the baggage and the garbage out of the way that some reasonable progress could be made on obvious agenda items. So how then did we get from relatively pragmatic cooperation from 2009 to 2011-12 to where we are today? I submit to you that the breakdown had very little to do with Ukraine and happened long before the Euromaidan broke out. If you look at late 2011-2012, Vladimir Putin was obsessed with the notion that the public protests then going on the streets of Moscow, St. Petersburg, and other large Russian cities were orchestrated out of Washington, if not directly funded, if not American agents actually taking part in them on the ground. And at that precise moment, Ambassador Mike McFaul, ironically the man who had been seen as the author of the reset inside the Obama administration, arrives in Moscow as the ambassador of the United States. And of course, McFaul is famous for having written Russia's Unfinished Revolution, and the perception very clearly was he was here to finish the job. I suggest that was very bad timing, but certainly not seen, almost nothing is ever seen as accidental from Moscow, let me put it that way. But adding insult to injury, though in 2012 the United States and Russia finally succeeded in pushing through Russia's accession to the WTO, it came at the cost of a new sanctions bill against Russia. Jackson-Vanik is removed, and the Magnitsky Act is imposed. Magnitsky, of course, entering a very serious and grave human rights abuse that occurred in Russia, but the perception on the Russian side is, you know, you have never graduated from the notion that we are the enemy, that you have to sit in judgment of us, and that you have to tell us what kind of system we need to have. So the relationship is deteriorating at this point already on all levels. Russia warns the United States it will respond asymmetrically. It does so by banning U.S. adoptions of Russian children, then banning U.S. funding for Russian NGOs and closing the doors on a number of NGOs, including many that I've been working with. And the message from Russia at this time, you're now talking about mid to late 2012, is very clearly what I call kind of burning Moscow to defend it. The idea that we will bring the house down around our own ears, even though losing partnerships and funding, losing the ability to send Russian orphans to loving well-off families in the West. None of these things are good for Russia. But to punish you and to demonstrate that what you are doing is unacceptable, we will burn the city down around us. And that, I think, has been a consistent theme in Russia's response to the United States and the West since that moment. Of course, adding fuel to the fire further, we have the Boston Marathon bombing in 2013. Remember how that's covered in the United States, by the way, Russian terrorists, right? The Tsarnaev brothers. Ironically, from the Russian perspective, right, these are the terrorists they wish that we had helped them fight all along, going all the way back to the 1990s. And here the Magnitsky Act comes into play again. All stuff that, by the way, I mean, you know, raise your hand if you saw any of this covered in the American press. Two of the names on the Magnitsky Act were senior Russian security officials responsible for the exact region in the North Caucasus, Dagestan, where the Tsarnaev brothers had been holed up for about 6 months, ostensibly getting training and inspiration for what then became the Boston Marathon bombing. And we in the United States were infuriated that these officials, whom we had put on a sanctions list a year and a half before, were not sharing intelligence with us about the Tsarnaev brothers, right? Tragic situation, but based fundamentally on misperception, misunderstanding, and offense and grievance. The Ryan Fogel spying scandal, Edward Snowden, Russia's adoption of anti-gay laws, the conviction of Alexei Navalny, this darling of the West, Russian opposition leader. Obama cancels his summit with Putin in August of 2013. And then finally, in November, the protests break out in Ukraine, but initially very much not a U.S.-Russia problem, very much a Ukrainian domestic problem. The bigger factor in late 2013, early 2014, is the story of the Sochi Olympics, right? This is an event in which Vladimir Putin has invested a huge amount of personal prestige, at least $50 billion, we now know. Again, what's the coverage of this story in the West? Russia is a terrible country. The Sochi Olympics are a joke. The toilets don't work. The sinks don't work. It's a Potemkin village. And more importantly, Western leaders aren't going to go. They're not going to go because Russia has human rights problems. And so what does Vladimir Putin do? He releases Mikhail Khodorkovsky, the most notorious political prisoner, right? The oligarch who had dared to oppose him 10 years earlier and was in Siberian exile. He releases Pussy Riot, right? The famous masked punk rockers. He releases the Greenpeace activists. He even releases a number of the protesters who had threatened him in 2011 and 2012 and below that. Am I saying that Vladimir Putin is a trustworthy soul, a good man, a Democrat? No, I'm not saying any of this. I'm saying he really, really wanted to be respected by the West in late 2013, early 2014. And what did he get? He got none of it. Senior Western officials, by and large, stayed away from Sochi. And so this, I suggest, is really the straw that broke the camel's back. Vladimir Putin comes back from Sochi, and the very next thing that happens, we now know, is he convenes his National Security Council, and he says, we need to take Crimea. And from that moment forward, I think the story is very well known to you, right? Sanctions, isolation, tit for tat, and the relationship that we have today. So let me just say a quick word, if I have 2 minutes, about what I think Russia is looking for in Ukraine. I think there are three basic causes, and the first two of them in the sequence here is very, very important, are domestic. So number one is the precedent of removing Yanukovych by force, whether you think it was morally justified or not. He was a duly elected leader who was removed through a street protest that became violent. If life in Ukraine becomes better after that, if people are better off and if big businesses are better off in Ukraine, next year, 5 years from now, 10 years from now, whenever it happens, that message will be unacceptably dangerous for Putin and Russia for the simple reason that Russians overwhelmingly believe that they and Ukrainians are the same, right? Despite the rhetoric about Ukrainian fascists and Ukraine going to NATO and so on, fundamentally, deep family, personal, historical, cultural, religious, and all kinds of other ties. And the view is, if this happens in Ukraine and the result is better for Ukrainians, why not us? Why not Russians? And this is an unacceptable precedent for Putin and his system. It's about survival. And second, along that same line, again, domestic political, is that Vladimir Putin's role today is very different. I described him 15 years ago as being kind of a pragmatist, a realist. Certainly that was the moment at which he and George W. Bush had the famous meeting in Slovenia. He was a very different man then. Now he is a tsar, which means he has extreme, supreme, absolute power, but he is also isolated. I think it's impossible to describe Vladimir Putin today as a realist. Many people talk about him as a strategist, as a realist. In order to be a realist, you have to acknowledge your own fallibility, that you might sometimes be wrong. And if you are at that pinnacle of absolute power, where you are isolated and surrounded by yes men and everyone is afraid of you, you can no longer be a realist. And what that means is Putin cannot afford to acknowledge the possibility, publicly or privately, that his narrative about what has happened in Ukraine, again, CIA-backed coup, unleashing radical fascist Ukrainian nationalists to commit ethnic cleansing upon Russians and then to bring reorient Ukraine into the EU and NATO, that might be wrong in any way. That is an impossible premise to accept because it is the beginning of the end of his absolute power, which is akin to that of a Tsar. Only the third and final place in this logical scheme is occupied by geopolitics, which is what we tend to hear about first in the West, right? Does Ukraine go east or west? And the idea here is even more complicated. There's a positive version of the narrative, and that's simply that Russia or Ukraine, but Ukraine in particular by itself, is relatively small and relatively weak, right? This is a country whose GDP is, you know, something around the net worth of Bill Gates plus Warren Buffett, maybe less than that. Right? And it's a pretty dysfunctional country, and it's a country that has an awful lot of trouble borrowing on commercial markets. So Ukraine doesn't have a lot of bargaining power. And the message of Russia's Eurasian Economic Union is, if you join with us, you will have more bargaining power, right? Russia alone is 140 million people. Russia plus Ukraine plus Kazakhstan plus Belarus plus Armenia, et cetera, is over 200 million people. And the ability for that common market to then get better terms from, say, China, or better terms from the EU, and ultimately strive towards something resembling, and Putin has talked about this, a Lisbon to Vladivostok common European market, or European and Eurasian. That's actually a relatively appealing message. What's the negative message? We know very well. I call it the Gandalf-Balrog moment, right? Where Putin throws down the staff and says, you shall not pass to NATO, right? NATO cannot come to Ukraine. It is a bridge too far. And so every time we see footage of American troops drilling with Ukrainians on the company level in Western Ukraine, it is a symbol of everything that is anathema and hateful to the Russians in Ukraine. So that's a sort of sense of how we've gotten to where we are, what the Russians are looking for in Ukraine. Let me just lastly say, in terms of broad principles, how we can deal with the Russians under these circumstances, and I hope that these are useful as we continue the conversation to talk about arms control and potentially, very potentially, disarmament issues. I'd keep these principles in mind. Number one, Russia's not going away, right? This tends to be obvious to the nuclear community, is far from obvious to almost everyone else. I will tell you right now, coming from the highest levels of our government, the message about Russia policy is, our job is to manage the consequences for U.S. interests of Russia's inevitable decline into irrelevance, right? If you perceive Russia that way, you do not take Russia seriously. So principle number one is Russia's not going away. We've got to take it seriously, and it can't be bludgeoned. Number two, our ability to secure cooperation from Russia depends on the institutional foundation of the relationship. So if we have no trade, if we have no travel visa exchange, if we have no official track to the relationship below the level of John Kerry doing shuttle diplomacy or Barack Obama or Angela Merkel as a middleman, we have no institutional foundation. How do you talk to Russia about the hard issues, the things that very quickly can derail issues like arms control when we want to work on those? Find a common language to talk about problems like human rights. Don't go lecturing to the Russians about what kind of democracy they should have. Talk about the interests of U.S. businesses operating in Russia, that they need rule of law in order to operate, that they need rule of law in order to invest and conduct business. Talk about reciprocal commitments, the Helsinki commitments, the UN Declaration on Human Rights, the Vienna Convention, the European Convention on Human Rights, WTO, G8. Of course, we kicked them out of the G8, so it makes it kind of hard to talk about reciprocal commitments and so on. And then a little bit more honesty about the political constraints of our process here in Washington. I'd love to hear the Jerry Maguire line from President Obama. Maybe it's too late. Help me help you. Right? When you do things domestically, when you do things in Ukraine that make it difficult for me to sell U.S.-Russia partnership to my own party, let alone to the Republican side, you derail your own best interests here in the United States. There's been very little of that honesty, and there's a lot of kind of mirror imaging where Russians assume our system is like their system, right? So if John McCain says something nasty about Putin, it must be because the president authorized him to do so, right? We need a lot more honesty about how our systems work. And then lastly, just know something about Russia, right? There's been a precipitous decline, not only in broad public investment, private foundations, et cetera, in study of Russia, but by the government in particular. We're down to less than 20% of where we were in 1991 in terms of investment in university Russian studies programs, postgraduate Russian studies, Russia exchanges, like, for example, the Open World Program run by the Library of Congress. All of these things have been massively slashed, in most cases either eliminated or more than 50%. So if you've got no capacity to understand the other party, be wary of imposing constraints, sanctions, et cetera, and assuming you know how those are going to end. Thanks.
Matt, thank you. Very insightful. Combining a Tolkien and Napoleonic burning of Moscow is quite an achievement. Now, Catherine, Secretary Kerry said at his Tuesday meeting in Sochi, quote, "It is clearly possible to make real progress and make important things happen," unquote. So my question to you is that true? And what kind of arms control should we try to make happen through engagement with Russia?
Well, luckily we have here Clue Audiovisual Aid, the Deep Cuts Commission, and at least some specific recommendations about what we can do to at least bring up for conversation or dispute, should you choose to. But I'd like to say perhaps a more general thing, and this very much in tribute to John Steinbrenner, because I think he was my friend for almost 50 years. We shared a love of Berlin as students and a doctoral advisor, some time and place at Brookings and at Maryland. And I think also this approach, which he perhaps more than many other people in Washington constantly reminded us of. And it seemed to me it had three major dimensions that are very useful, particularly in contrast to the kind of minute-by-minute zigzag that Matt has so well described of our policy towards Russia, and particularly in the arms control field. His argument would have been, I think, first, keep your eye on the long haul. Don't worry about what's happening today in specific, but concentrate on what your aims are and what the kinds of objectives you have for the medium and longer term. That it is only through doing that that you have a realistic measuring stick against both what you do today and what you're hoping will add up cumulatively to a more positive result in terms of U.S. interests and indeed in terms of a more cooperative strategy. I think secondly, and John very much stressed this not only in his own writing, but also I think in his teaching, which was the importance of transparency and openness in every single endeavor. That it is really the question about looking at yourself honestly, as Matt just said, and also trying very hard to keep an open mind, to look for opportunities where this kind of strategy will in fact lead to coincident, if not necessarily joint, outcomes. That it is the light of day that will make the difference in the end on whether or not things are politically acceptable. That much that is done behind closed doors not only should stay there, or perhaps never happen at all. I think a third thing, and here probably his hallmark in all of his writing and things that he did, not only with ACA, but with the National Academy of Sciences activities and the American Academy of Sciences, the arts and sciences that he was involved in, was really the stress on innovation. Let's think of a different way if we need to. Let's put the pressure on ourselves to think about how we adapt and how we adjust to new circumstances. And surely that would be his message, I think, as we look forward to what is achievable at a time of considerable stress, a lot of tension, and a lot of turbulence in who knows what about what. I think there's no question, as most of the people in this room have reluctantly concluded over the last 2 years, that there is not going to be a rapid U-turn, short of some extraordinary black swan variety activity, or perhaps violence of a kind that none of us would like to see. I think, moreover, that the need to reconsider what we have done in the past, as Matt has outlined it, is a very serious task. And EASY certainly tried to do that in its time. But more importantly, I think for the Deep Cuts Commission and for our own activities individually and as a group, this community on that has focused on arms control, it's time to stop kidding ourselves about the things that we have carefully but rather casually assumed were going to be eternal verities that would extend into the future. We've had a lot of reliance on institutions that we've failed to support. We've not been terribly innovative. We've just assumed that everything was linear development rather than the zigzag that John would have been among the first to mention is often the fate of human affairs. It can get worse, and it will get worse unless we do take this task seriously. There are lots of cases. I'm happy to recount a long list of possible things that have gone wrong, taken a turn, and then never recovered. I'm sure you have some, both from your personal life. The financial sector may be one of them that comes closest to mind at the moment, but that really have to do with the need. The unexamined life, as someone once said, is not worth living. And I would say the unexamined policy life is even particularly not worthy of commanding attention or effort. So enough of the philosophy, but I think an important way to start to remind ourselves that there is plenty of guilt to go around about how we have gotten ourselves into this situation. Mr. Putin may have taken 25 years of my professional life and thrown it into the circular file, but that's okay, as long as out of that I'm able to rescue some hope and some positive direction for what I think is the future. And here I think the Deep Cuts Commission at least provides us a handy discussion guide from which to go forward. Deep Cuts was a commission funded primarily by the German Foreign Office and several foundations, which is made up of 21 members with associated friends and relatives, as we say, who has bravely been looking at these problems for the last 3 years, and with considerable results. The first and second reports, there may yet be a third, I think are worth reading and thinking about. Again, I think there is a great deal of emphasis on the kinds of values that I see John's work as comprising, particularly the emphasis on the willingness to take the context where you are and to go forward. We are not going to have major breakthroughs, but we may yet do useful work that's preparatory for opportunities that we can't foresee exactly when they're going to happen, but where we suspect that if we keep working at the coalface, there will be a chance in which to achieve the kinds of reductions, not only in nuclear arms, but in the control of the weaponry innovation process and indeed the many supporting functions and infrastructure that are so critical to the conduct of warfare. It is an optimistic view, one that says, we can do it if we keep our eye on the ball and not just either surrender to despair or to demagoguery, as is too often the case in this town anyway. I think probably the major push within the Deep Cuts Commission, there are five really specific areas for recommendations in this current second report. But the major one is clearly the continuation in discussions about strategic nuclear arms control. The push to continue to think about how it is possible to achieve or to outline or to find a basis for coincident interests, not just, but primarily perhaps between the United States and Russia, but also including the three members of the other members of the P5, and perhaps even stretching beyond to a P5 plus two, including India and Pakistan, in terms of targets for reduction. The idea that there are offers still on the table that involve considerably lower levels of nuclear weapons, that suggest that a partnership, how many nations was it that came to the partnership in verification meeting recently, that there is a partnership of like-minded states that can take up verification questions, involve themselves in the kind of experimentation about verification, about satisfying the how will you ever know complaint that has dogged arms control from its very beginning in the 60s. I think, moreover, there is a push to think about what we are doing, as we always have to think, in our present weapons acquisitions and weapons development that will, in fact, contain rocks or perhaps even explosions of our best intentions in the future. Here, the hypersonic glide, the question of precision guidance, the question of new and improved conventional or perhaps even nuclear cruise missiles, all are items that are mentioned in the Deep Cuts Commission. The need to worry now and to think about what we actually want to achieve in each of those areas if we have the chance to continue to push on our agenda. It gives pride of place in a way, at least in the present agenda, to restoring a kind of strategic stability in Europe. And here, particularly to take more seriously than anyone in the United States perhaps has ever done, the possibilities that exist in the one remaining forum in which we are continuing to meet regularly with the Russians, the OSCE, and to try to think what we want that organization to be and how strong we need to make it in order to fulfill even its original mandate. If not that, what is it that we want in terms of an organizational framework in which we will be able to take account of the inevitable geopolitical fact, as Matt described it, that Russia is not going away and that it needs to be a partner. It needs to be a conversation partner. It needs to be a partner in common, perhaps only convergent interest-driven organizations, and that without the kind of channel of engagement and information, it really is a question of how we communicate, fits and starts, things that can be turned off by either side with no particular price to be paid. This includes the INF Treaty and the need now to think about how we want to use that mechanism, how we can strengthen it, how we can, in fact, either by unilateral or perhaps even convergent methods, strengthen it for to include others or to replace it with something that represents a verifiable ban on a set of weaponry that has proved difficult, if not disastrous, in the past. Last but not least is, of course, the whole area that we are currently discussing in New York, namely the Non-Proliferation Treaty and the associated activities. We've had a number of specific actions. We have the action plan of the past that still is not what might be called implemented. We have other models that have been suggested and that need to be looked at. Most importantly of all, we need to look at the sort of kind of proliferation that we're seeing on a number of levels, both in terms of our discussions with India and currently in the Iran context. I think all of these things, as discussed in the Deep Cuts Commission report, suggest there is a great deal of work to be done and that it is not enough to say, Mr. Putin promised that it would be 10 years before there would be any serious arms control again, and it's a promise, at least as long as he's in charge, he has every intention of making sure it comes true. I think for lots of reasons, it will take even longer than that if his plan is to go forward. What we have to think about in the meantime, and I think John would have joined me in this plea, is to say, we have time, and we had best make use of it to think about what it is that we really need to do, want to do, and what kinds of things we and other states that share our goals can do, not necessarily in opposition to Mr. Putin, that's his choice as well as ours, but rather to think about how we can engage in cooperative strategies that will lead to the goals and to the eventual opportunity for agreements, unilateral actions, bilateral, multilateral, agreements of all sorts, formal and informal, that will push us forward into the kind of cooperative space that I think is so necessary to achieve our own goals.
Thank you, Catherine. I'm not going to exercise the moderator's prerogative. I'm going to open it up to questions right away from the floor. And I think we will try to bundle the questions just in pairs so that we don't forget what those questions were and we maximize the chance for you to ask them. So please raise your hand and we'll try to get a mic to you. I see Michael over here and Jim here for the first two questions.
Thanks. So thank you both for wonderful presentations. I hope we get to applaud them at some point. I have a question for Matt, but either of you could weigh in on this. How does the Russia-China relationship bear on U.S.-Russian relations? And I say this reading this morning that Ash Carter is talking about stationing B-1 bombers in Australia. That's going to drive the Chinese crazy, is my I just imagine. Mm. And make them much more, militarized in their response. And is that going to turn them to Russia? How does that affect Putin? How does that affect U.S.-Russian relations?
Thank you both for excellent speeches. I enjoyed it very much. I shouldn't call it a speech. Remarks. I have a question for both of you. You both talked about the idea of some kind of a organizational arrangement in the Euro-Atlantic region. Matt, you talked about what I thought was a very important report, the Euro-Atlantic Security Initiative, and one other followed it that Sam Nunn was involved in. And Catherine talked about the OSCE, which I think is also a forum that needs to a hard look. But what can we do? I'd really like to hear you talk more specifically about what kind of a forum you would like to see in Europe, in the Euro-Atlantic region. Is it something that grows out of the OSCE? Is it something new, as the Euro-Atlantic Security Initiative suggested? And is there any way of reviving some of those ideas? Thanks.
Okay, let's go first, Matt, to the Russia-China question.
Okay. So, I think it was Henry Kissinger who had the maxim about the United States should adopt a policy in which we have better relations with Beijing and Moscow than they have with each other, that should be the maxim. That does not pertain today. The opposite is true. Full stop, without question, we should have no illusions. Whatever our mutual economic dependence with China, there is no doubt that Beijing and Moscow see each other as closer partners. I won't say more important simply because of the size and weight of the U.S.-China economic relationship, but closer partners than they are with either of them is with us. That is often dismissed in Washington. If you read English language analysis of the Russia-China relationship, including a piece out yesterday in Reuters by several of my colleagues, whom I respect enormously, there's often a tone of sort of disbelief or non-seriousness based on history, the idea that the Russians and the Chinese have fought lots of wars with each other, lots of border skirmishes, and there are these sort of deep trends that will always keep the two of them distrustful and prickly towards one another. That's all true. Let me tell you what else is true. Putin and Xi have an excellent personal dynamic, and they will both be in power for the next decade or more. The Russian and the Chinese cultural and historical narrative is finding increasingly common resonance in response to Western policy. So when we isolate, when we denigrate, when we talk about Russian and Chinese behavior as being 19th century or uncivilized or inappropriate to our sort of modern rules and norms, it echoes with a sense that both great powers, as they see themselves, have always experienced at the hands of the European West, and that is that you denigrate us, you isolate us, and we emerge stronger for it. That is a common, I can go into the details and the terminology for this, but it, suffice to say it exists in both cultures. The weapons trade is very real. As you may know, the S-400s that were sold to China, recently promised to China by Russia, would give the Chinese essentially airspace denial capability over Taiwan. That's a really, really big deal. And the Russians, I think, are signaling something important by making that sale. And then the economy. There is a functional modus vivendi between Russia and China in Central Asia, where the Chinese get economic dominance and the Russians get political and military dominance. That's working. But more importantly, the Russian-Chinese direct economic relationship is big and it's growing. And the $500 billion gas deal, although the details, people sort of snicker, well, we don't know what the price is, oh, the Russians got screwed. Look, we don't know is the operative term, and they nonetheless signed the deal. And two leaders who are obsessed with personal prestige, note what I said earlier about Sochi, signed that deal in public, associated themselves with it in public. So I suggest to you that that's a very real deal and it's very, very big.
I would like to add a somewhat dissenting voice to this and to argue that one of the hallmarks, I think, of long-term Russian policy and is an increasing nationalist, xenophobic strand, and one in which has more than a little of a racist trend. And whether one talks particularly about the military, where it's rampant, or in terms of the general reliance in outside of Moscow in the major cities on this kind of definition of Russianness that is non-Asiatic, very definitely a cultural empire with long tradition. I think that is a major stumbling block. As long as Putin and his successors are dependent on that kind of nationalist support, it will always be a question from the Russian side about who is dominant. And there is, it seems to me, if I were Mr. Putin, I would run that calculus very carefully, since there are many indications that suggest it will not be Russia that's the dominant partner. And once that becomes apparent, I think it puts a great deal of question into how long and how deep this particular present relationship will run. But may I also speak to Jim Goodby's very good question? You know, lots of trees have died in the search for European security architecture. I think at one point I counted up there were either 52 or 53 different plans that had been published for how to set the organizational framework. I think it doesn't matter. It's clear that the NATO-Russia ploy is over, at least for the foreseeable future. And the question is, what's left? We have tended, particularly in the years, recent years in which we've more or less neglected, I think, the organizational underpinnings of the US-Russia relationship, and the certainly, as Matt wisely pointed out, the amount of non-tending of domestic expertise in this area. I think we really have to have a framework, however, where we meet whether we want to or not. That's one of the hallmarks of that framework. It's like the U.S. having to go to NATO and meet its allies, whether or not it wants to meet them all at once. You know, it's the convening power, if you will, and the fact that not showing up turns out to be disastrous. I think their OSCE is the only thing we've got at the moment. And unless we pick up something like the organization that was suggested, a linked organization that was Brzezinski and Kissinger's idea in 2011, 2012, there have been other arguments about having kind of a mini UN in Europe kind of meeting. But whatever the framework is, we need one. And the question is then to take it seriously. The United States has always held its nose in OSCE and said, not much here, not our play, not our vocabulary. And the fact is, as this crisis has shown, we have a need for this kind of organization. And it's not just to engage the Russians, it's to engage a number of other states as well.
Thank you, Catherine. We'll take the next two questions. I might just mention that there is more specificity in the Deep Cuts report, particularly on the OSCE forum, and also noting that the Germans are going to be chair of the OSCE coming up and see an opportunity for moving in that forum. So next two questions, let me try to go to the back a little bit, maybe in the middle there. First one, and then over Nick by the window.
Thank you. Mr. Rojansky mentioned that we are losing slowly our Russian expertise. Mm-hmm. And I was wondering what your thoughts are on Peace Corps volunteers. So obviously there's the problem of we don't want other nations to think that we're spying on them, but at least for the case with Ukraine, there were at least 400 volunteers in Ukraine, and they seem like they could be a good resource for getting the lay of the land, so to speak. I mean, they have very, very good relationships with the locals, et cetera, even in the east, in Donetsk. So I'm just wondering what your thoughts are on that. Thank you.
And at the end of the question, could I just ask you to identify yourself? Sorry, I should have mentioned that.
Oh, sure. My name is Adam Prevost. I'm a graduate student at the Monterey Institute of International Studies.
Nick Roth, Belfer Center. Thank you. Both of your talks were very interesting. One question I have is about a specific type of cooperation that was cut off early in 2014 between the U.S. and Russia, which is joint scientific research. And that was cut off on the U.S. side. So my question for both of you is, based on your presentations, I would think that you would think you would decide that that was not a wise decision. But so I guess one question is, do you agree with that or not? And if not, what case would you make to the U.S. government on why and or how that type of cooperation should continue or restart?
Let me pick up the cooperative question, Nick. I think there are two very good sides to the argument about whether or not we should have cut off cooperative links. How much of it was cutting off our own nose? How much of it was a real signal that we were serious this time? So let's leave that discussion to the past. I think what we could think of is, what is the sequence? What is the series of domains in which we want to gradually restore some of those links because they're useful for us? Or we see that this is a way to at least engage the Russians in a dialogue that is has the possibility of leading to further cooperation if that's what we want. I think there are two that I think have been very useful, and the Deep Cuts argument actually comes out and says 1.5 and 2 level dialogues are the first place to invest. I think it's been extremely useful to have the mill-to-mill dialogue. It has not turned out always in the best way, I must say, for the Russian military participants. A large number of them have found themselves without jobs when they went home or under great suspicion of having been turned by the CIA. But the idea of having open meetings, which are transparent, that do in fact convince other observers that there is something to be discussed is a very important one. Let me give you one specific example. Almost nobody knows about the cooperative discussions that have gone on both in North East Asia at the colonel's level for well over 10 years. And it's a question of not just arriving at individual personal knowledge, but a sort of background that has to do with signaling, the sort of, if you will, creation of trusted persons, people who are looked on as experts or points of contact from both sides as being of value. These turn out in specific crises, particularly when you need to send a signal fast, to be very, very useful techniques. They are of in and of themselves a kind of confidence-building measure that's of some value. I think in the scientific area this is also the case. I think there's much less emphasis on it. Things like Pugwash or the Dartmouth discussions or any number of other scientific exchanges than there was, say, in the heydays of the 70s. But it is there is still a vast area in which, even with the open, relatively open scientific dialogues that exist in functional fields, it is a valuable resource to have, if only because it's precisely this kind of organization that can try trial balloons, develop stakeholders, do the kinds of things that are so difficult to do in something like the NATO-Russia Forum, where you started with adversarial relations from the first.
And which, by the way, is still frozen or suspended. It might be good news to you and to others here. I don't think I'm violating any confidentiality by saying that the Dartmouth conference at the plenary level, the high level that was suspended in 1990, has actually restarted with support from the Kettering Foundation, which sort of has taken over that brand since November of last year. And in fact, the next high level meeting is slated for the fall here on the U.S. side. So, and this scientific exchange is exactly on the agenda. We've had very senior doctors, for example, and the issue really is, do you see useful capacity on both sides? A problem from the U.S. side for a long time has been just general dismissiveness of Russia's relevance and capacity. If they have nothing to offer, why do we need to do anything jointly with them? What, just for the sake of going through the motions? No, we don't do that sort of thing. And, of course, the reality is they have a tremendous amount to offer. If you know basic economics, right, it's the idea of comparative advantage. It doesn't matter even if they're 10% less good than you. They may specialize in something that you don't, and that makes sense. On the human capital issue, the answer, Adam, is yes. Returned Peace Corps volunteers are extremely valuable. I've actually hired at least two of them myself. But, you know, that's not the only program, and the problem with Peace Corps is it's not in Russia. It's only in Ukraine and Georgia and other former Soviet republics. And that phenomenon has become a kind of troublesome two-way street where, on the one hand, we can't actually go to the places and gain experience in the places where engagement with Americans and American knowledge is most urgently needed because we're barred from those places, perceived as being some form of espionage or soft color revolutionary activity by Putin initially back in 2002, which is why he booted the program. But on the other hand, we often come back with a version of post-Soviet knowledge that is skewed towards the countries where we have these large contingencies of Peace Corps volunteers. So it tends over time to shape the field such that throughout the State Department and the Defense Department and Commerce and other places now, when you're sitting down with a now mid-level, working-level official who started out as a Peace Corps volunteer, which is a common phenomenon, their language was Ukrainian, right? And so it sort of deepens the problem. And I'm not saying there's not a problem with engaging with Ukraine. I'm all for it. I started the Ukraine program when I was here at Carnegie. It's just that the perception from the Russian side, again, it's a two-way street. They banned us in the first place, but then we invest in human capital that, as a result, makes it even harder for us to deal with them because we're perceived as being biased. So it's tricky.
Thank you. One up front and one in the far back.
Shall I be loud or should I wait for a microphone?
You should wait for the mic.
Okay.
My name is Richard Golden. I'm a member of the ACA. I'm also a Rotarian. As a Rotarian, I have been active in Russia-U.S. exchanges. I've been told by people who I believe are much more knowledgeable than I today, NGOs is where it is at. Do you have any comments as to whether NGOs might want to take the lead in reestablishing constructive exchanges between the two countries?
Hi, Brian Bradley from Nuclear Security and Deterrence Monitor. One line in the Deep Cuts Commission report particularly caught my eye and raised another question for me, the line where it said the U.S. and Russia should resist misleading calls to give up on the INF treaty. My question is, given the fact that both sides are basically accusing each other of violating the treaty, what is the action chain that would have to happen to get both sides basically to agree on the provisions and agree on cooperation on the treaty going forward? And also, Ms. Kelleher, I believe you touched on the possibility of replacing, negotiating a replacement for the INF treaty going forward. How do you envision that playing out, given the status of INF right now?
Let me say something about the INF treaty, since that was one of the subjects I was significantly involved with. One is struck by the absence of any activity in resolving the INF treaty compliance concern on the table of anything like that envisioned by the authors of the treaty. The Special Verification Commission that was supposed to work on compliance concerns last met in 2003. It has not been engaged in any way in this dispute, and there are some reasons for that having to do with the fact that there was only the Soviet Union once upon a time, and now there were several members that kind of inherited the treaty. But the point is, and this came out very strongly in the Deep Cuts discussions, you really have to have technical experts, military professionals, people on the ground, on the spot, working through these issues. And when the U.S. and Russia tried to resolve the U.S. complaint, it was at a very high level, and the Russians basically kept saying, "We don't know what you're talking about," and the U.S. kept saying, "Yes, you do." and that sort of led us to where we are now. I see an opportunity here in using the Russian complaints about U.S. violations of the INF treaty to use that as leverage. The U.S. has been dismissive of all of those complaints, including the potential use of the launchers that are destined for Romania and Poland, that their maker, Boeing, bragged could also launch Tomahawk missiles, and now we assure the Russians that neither the software nor the hardware would allow them to launch Tomahawk missiles. That is a very easy opportunity for us to say, come and look at this equipment. We will show you why it is impossible. We, as far as I know, have not made such a suggestion at all. Were we to suggest that, then it would be much easier for us to say, and we would like to look at our complaints about your testing of a ground-launched cruise missile. So I think there needs to be an attitudinal change, first and foremost, on the U.S. part, in order to try to make progress on what I think is a very legitimate complaint about what the Russians have done. Let me go to others. Yeah. Catherine?
Can I just add on to Greg's very cogent argument? I think two mistakes were made specifically. One is we decided, for reasons that I still am not clear about, in the Bush administration to leave the Russians to fight the extension of the INF treaty scope, the joining perhaps of other countries, to leave that to a Russian lead. And we didn't make it a very important priority in terms of our own negotiating agenda. And we essentially said we didn't see it as terribly urgent. And this having to do with extending the treaty, both perhaps to include the Chinese, the Indians, and the Pakistanis, all of whom have programs of interest, shall we say. And we essentially allowed that one to run into the sand. I think that was a mistake on our part, a serious mistake. It would have looked like a much more important and persuasive push, I think, if we had enlarged the scope at least to force discussion. If we couldn't do it in MTCR, we could have forced a discussion about their plans, what they saw as the impact on strategic stability in their particular regions, in a way that would have been very useful for us at several points. The second thing, and I think the more important thing, is the escalation of this discussion with the Russians resembles a schoolyard fight more than anything else. I mean, so's your old man is the sum of a lot of the discussion. And I think we should, we've been forced into a position that really is beneath our dignity, if you may allow me a judgment. And we could have done other things at other points. And it's just been folded into the general discouragement, disappointment, disregard, whatever you want to say about policies too often in the last 5 years.
I have to take this opportunity before this panel concludes to make a very important broader point in answer to the INF problem and a number of others, like Russian participation in the Nuclear Security Summit, what we may or may not get from them on the NPT RevCon. Bottom line is, we ourselves should know, imposing economic sanctions in response to military action, that all issues are linked, right? That you cannot deal in total isolation with one set of issues from another set of issues. And what that means is my well-meaning, but I think totally misguided colleagues who write op-eds in the same week, publishing op-eds in the very same week saying, let's send weapons to the Ukrainians so they can bleed the Russians more, so they can send home more Russian body bags and change Putin's calculus. And in the very same week say, let's not give up on the INF. It blows my mind, right? I mean, we're not dealing with some kind of robot here, right? We are dealing with people. And with people, issues are linked. We ought to understand that. So I think that point just needs to stand. And then on NGOs, Richard, this speaks to the two-way street problem, right, which is that the Russians have created a very tight environment for NGO activity in their own country. They have a foreign agent law which says any NGO which is receiving foreign money or which is acting in general on the interests at the behest of a foreign partner, that NGO will be labeled a foreign agent, and that's essentially a poison pill in Russian society. So what you're left with, and my own organization has been evolving in this direction, is that you cannot invest overly in what you would ideally want to do, which is build institutions on the ground, you know, employ Russians, get Russians going in activities that are of mutual interest. What you have to do is look for opportunities where existing Russian institutions are looking on the basis of total, formal, almost very archaic-seeming, almost Cold War-style equality, right? You sit opposite each other at the table and have little flags, and you negotiate memoranda of understanding, and you sign those. That's the nature of the partnership that the Russian government is allowing today. And if you try to circumvent that, you're likely to get yourself and your Russian NGO partner in a lot of trouble. So I would discourage that under the current circumstances. But we've got to push through. Pulling back completely and saying, we're going to punish you by not engaging, you know, that's obviously a mistake because you lose the Russian people.
Thank you very much for your questions. I'm afraid we have run out of our allotted time. And I would urge you to join me in thanking our two panelists.